Hey, Shafiq, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Hi, I'm sorry I was stuck in traffic. So, let us start the today's session. We will have the question and answer at the end of the class. So first of all, I'll just tell you that we are going to discuss today these two concepts. One is call by value and the other one is exception handling. That is very important in Java. So first we will discuss about call by value. Call by value is call by value. So there are two things, call by value and call by reference. Reference, okay. Call by value and call by reference. Call by value in Java, only call by value is supported. Call by reference is not supported. Okay. Now what is call by value? So when we call a method passing a value, like when you pass a value from the object to the you set the value, set x. You used one of the methods yesterday. You set the value for x by passing it some value, right? So when we call a method passing a value, it is known as call by value. Okay. The changes being done in the called method is not affected in the calling method. I'll show you how it works. So first of all, let me write a program for call by value. And then I will explain it to you how it works. Let's say we have a class. Call by value. And it has a variable x. It responded. Then there is a method void change. I'll say it is y. And then I will say y equals to y plus. I'll explain it to you. Let me just complete it. Then we have the main method. Public static void main. We have call by value class. I will create an object here, B. B equals to new call by value. Then we will display the resultant here, whatever we have added above. So before change, whatever the value is, before change is going to be b dot. We have y, so we will be accessing that here. Before change, what is the value of y? Okay. And then what is the value after change, when we will be passing some value? So we are going to pass some value to change method. Change, and we will pass some value like 200. Be stored here in B. Okay. Let me make it Y and then v dot y, and this is after change. So let me just put a semicolon here, and this is after change v dot y. First of all, you have a class created, then you have a variable y, you are passing that variable here. Now what will happen is, here we are saying before change, when we will be passing the value 200, it will be stored in int y. Change, in change we are passing a value here 200, which will be stored in int y, and then it will be calculated here. So y equals to, y will become what? Let's see, the value will be changed. Before and after the value will be changed. So initially it was 100 plus 50. Initially it was 100 plus 50, right? So it was 150. Before change it was 150, and after change it will be 200 plus 50, so it's going to be 250. Why this is called pass by value? Because the value before passing is unchanged in the method. The value before passing is unchanged in the method. That is why we say call by value or pass by value. Okay. Okay, so there is not any error. Let's run this. I'm just trying to run it. So we are passing a value here that is 200, right? So 200, and then let's say we have a statement here, system dot out, dot print ln, and then we are printing while after change. Okay, so you can see before change the value is b dot y, which is 100. When we are passing the value is getting changed here. When we are passing the value is getting changed here. Understandable?
Yes.
So this is call by value. Now if you have to notice one more thing here. Whatever the change you are doing, whatever the change we are trying to, you know, make in the method, in the call method, which method we are calling? We are calling the method change. So this method is not affecting the calling method. The change method, the changes, whatever the changes you are making, you are trying to make in the called method. So we are calling this method change. That is not affected in the calling method. So there is a method which we are calling and there is a method which is being called, right? So we are calling from the method main. We are calling from the method main. The value is not affected here. Okay? But in the call method, the value is affected. Getting my point? From the method from which you are trying to pass the value, in that method, the value will not be changed. So you can see before change, the value is 100, and after change, the value is 100. But in the called method, so we called this method, the value is affected. So this is pass by value or call by value. Okay, Satvik, shall I go ahead?
Yeah.
Okay. You can try to, if you want, you can try one more program. Okay. So what you can do, write a class. Okay. In that class, define an integer x equals to some value, integer x equals to 10. Okay. Then what you need to do, okay, that's something I'll have to think of some easier examples for you first. So let's say we want to add two numbers, okay, and what we have to pass the values, you know how to pass the values, right? So you can pass the value from here, from the main method. You can pass the value like I have passed 200. You will be passing value for x and y both, and then the calculation will be done here, okay. It will add two numbers here in the chain, basically the program is using call by value method. Add two numbers. So you will define a class, then you will have x and y, x, y and sum, okay. You will pass them x, y and sum you are going to pass, right. Then here you will say, actually you will not be passing sum, let's not pass sum, just x and y. Here you will say sum equals to x plus y. Int x, int y, right? And SOP, system out print line, sum, you will be printing here sum. You will go to the main part. In the main part you will create the object equals to new class, whatever the class name is. So here you have defined some things. X equals to 6, y equals to 7, right? So here you will say SOP object dot x plus object dot y. So it will add both the numbers. Then you will say before SOP, let's say here, let's say it here, before change the sum of numbers is plus then you will be passing values object dot add, pass some value 10 and 15, can you complete this? Is it understandable? Atvik? Atvik, are you there?
I'm here.
Okay, so is it easy to understand? You got it?
Yeah.
Okay, so can you complete this?
Okay.
Yeah, please complete it and let me know. Satvik, are you done? Satvik, are you done?
Almost.
Okay, good. Okay, please let me know when you are done. Okay, so did it work? Is it working?
It printed out, yeah, it printed out 13 point.
Two numbers, right? So first and third will be similar, right?
Yeah.
And the second one will be different, right? Okay, so that's yeah. What call by value is. Okay. Now we will cover. Okay, just give me one. I'm getting a call. Okay. I have a call. Okay, Satvik. So we are going to, talk about now exception handling. Okay. So exception handling. Now, if I just go ahead and here I say int. Okay. So you can say you can see here. It says exception in thread main, right? What is the exception? There is not any exception given, but it says exception in thread main. The method must return a result of type int, right? So there are the exception handling basically in Java, it helps. Okay, give me one moment, I'm so sorry. Yeah, so exception handling will help you in Java to handle the runtime errors. So when you try to run a program, you see some errors while running the program, like it says exception, it starts with the exception. And if you are already prepared when you write a program and when you are already prepared to handle any error, then that will be the best thing that's the best thing a developer can do. He will be prepared, and if he faces any sort of error or exceptions in the program, he can handle it later. So that's why the exception handling is introduced. So basically it will help you to handle the runtime errors so that the normal flow of the application will not be hampered. The normal flow of application will be maintained. So you can handle the runtime errors. Okay. So there are different type of exceptions in Java. Okay. So the type of exceptions, if I can say, there are three types: check exception, unchecked exception, and error. Okay. So these are the three types. Okay. First of all, we will talk about the checked exception. What is checked exception? So now you understand what is exception and what is handling. We are going to talk about the way we can handle it. So you understand what is an exception in programming?
Yes.
So the checked exception will be, there will be classes which will be extending the, so there are, first of all, you will need to understand that the hierarchy of exception classes. What is the hierarchy of the Java exception classes? So at the top you will see throwable class. Okay. Then there is, then the throwable class has two divisions. One is exception and the other is error. Okay. So we must understand the hierarchy of exception classes before we try to handle them. Okay. So throwable is a class at the top in exception classes, and the exception and errors are two things. Error can be mitigated, like in this case, this is an error. So this is an error where it says this method must return a result of type int. Right, so it is suggesting you something to fix this issue. If I go ahead and try to return something like, if I say return sorry, this is int, we are returning. Okay. This is int, we are returning. Okay, equals to okay, so this is some sort of error that we can try to fix. It will take few minutes to solve it. So let's go ahead. So I just want to say that there are exceptions and there are errors. Errors can be handled by doing some code changes, but in order to handle the exception, there is some other way. Okay. Now we will see how many types of exceptions we can have. How many type of exceptions we can have. So there can be IO exception. IO exception is, there is something wrong with input output. Input output, that is IO exception. Okay, then there is SQL exception. Something wrong with the database. Third, class not found exception. So if the class is not found, we are talking about in the program. Let's make it C and D. And there is runtime exception. If there is something wrong, you are trying to run the program at the runtime. Okay. In runtime exceptions, there can be so many. There are again different parts in the runtime exception. The runtime exception, you can say there can be arithmetic exception. Arithmetic exception, which is, for an example, if you try to divide 5 by 0, if you try to divide 5 by 0, let me go here. Try to divide 5 by 0. Okay. Let's say we are dividing y equals to y divided by 0. Okay. Let's see. So you can see it says exception in thread main, arithmetic exception. You are dividing it by 0. It's giving the arithmetic exception. So that's what I said here. Arithmetic exception that might occur there. Okay. Then there can be null pointer exception. Since you don't know about the pointers, pointers refer the memory location. If there is something wrong with the memory location, you have not stored anything and you are trying to find out something, like you are trying to add two numbers x plus y, you have not stored any number and you are trying to find the sum of them, so that is null. Null means zero. Okay. So that may give you the null pointer exception. Okay. Then you may see some array related exceptions, like array index out of bound, array index out of bound exception means it has crossed the limit of the array. If it can keep only 5 elements, you are trying to save more than 5 elements. So you may see these sort of errors. Okay. So these exceptions can be handled. Okay. Now we will talk about the errors. Now we will talk about the second part of it. So errors are basically when there is something wrong with the system, like virtual machine error, out of memory error, out of memory error. So there is not sufficient memory, your program is not running. Okay. So there are two things, exceptions and errors. Okay. You may handle the exceptions by writing some code, but the errors can be mitigated only by fixing them. Like if it says out of memory, then out of memory error cannot be just mitigated by writing some code. Okay. You'll have to fix the out of error issues. So far, clear? Shall I go ahead?
Sure.
Okay. Now we will talk about checked and the unchecked exceptions. Then we will talk about the errors. So first one is checked exception. So you just saw that, so whatever the classes which extend the throwable class, the classes which extend the throwable class, okay, except the runtime exception. There is a runtime exception, right? So any class which is extending these, like class not found, SQL exception, IO exception, any of these, any class if that is, you know, extending, and then you will say the error, whatever the error you see, you can say that these errors are checked exceptions. For an example, IO exception, SQL exception, okay. And checked exceptions are checked at the compile time of the program. So there are two things. You compile your program and then you run your program to see the output. You compile your program to check the syntax. Okay. So checked exceptions are classes where you extend the exception classes, the throwable classes, except the runtime exception, then the errors are known as checked exceptions. And examples, I have highlighted them. Now we will talk about the unchecked exceptions. So the classes which extend the runtime exception, the one that we left last time when we were talking about the checked exception, we talked that except runtime exception. But now in the unchecked exception, the classes which extend the runtime exception, they are known as unchecked exceptions. For an example, arithmetic exception, null pointer exception, array index out of bound. And these exceptions are checked at the runtime. These exceptions are checked at the runtime of the program. This will be checked, the checked exception is checked at the compile time. And this is checked at the runtime. Then we will talk about the errors now. The third type is error. So you have checked exception, unchecked exception, and then there is error. So basically the errors are, the errors cannot be recovered. Or you can fix it if there is something physically wrong or something like that, like out of memory error, virtual machine error, right? So these errors cannot be fixed, generally, the errors, when we talk about the exception handling. Now we are going to talk about very important, how to handle these exceptions. Okay, so you can use the try and catch blocks. Okay, you can use the try and catch block, which will help you to try the codes where you try the codes where you think that there can be exception, and then catch them. Catch them, what kind of exception is there. Okay, so for an example, try, close the try, and then there is catch, and the kind of exception you can think of, right? So if I said in this line, we are dividing it here, right? We are dividing it here, so we can say try this line, right? Then catch, what do you think? What kind of error here it can have? Arithmetic exception. So system dot out dot println whatever the message is. Okay, so look at this. Even if there is exception, even if there is exception in your program, the try and catch block, we are handling it by using the try and catch block. So it is saying before change it is 100, then what are you trying to do? You are trying to divide it by 0. What kind of exception you have? Arithmetic exception. After change the value is 200, you are changing it here. After change it is 200, it is printing it straight away, right? This value is 200 after change. So the try and catch block. So try block is used to enclose the code where you may seem that there might be some problem. It may throw some exception. Okay. So try block is used there. Okay. So try block must be followed either by catch or the finally block. Try block should must be followed either by catch or finally block. Okay. So what will the finally block do? If I say here, let me think of any good example. So the important thing is you should understand how the try and catch is used. Let's say we have finally here. But finally is not helping here, right? So okay, well, the previous example was good for try and catch block. Okay, let me just remove it. Okay. You can also try, you tried yesterday the array examples, right? So you can try if something is out of bound, and like you can try to, if there are 5 items, try to store 6 items. If the limit is 5, try to store 6 items and then you will see how that works. Okay. Sattvic, like here in this example we had some array here, I believe. Let me remove all these. So we have 3 and 3, I will say A 4, 4th position, And let's say we have the three here and we have one here. That's equals to 10. Okay, try to run this. First of all, remove this one. So you can see there is array index out of bound exception, right? Satvik, so how will you fix it? How will you fix it? You can try that block. The block is this. You can try that piece of code where you think there is some exception, okay? Then in the catch, you can put the kind of exception you think there might be. Okay?
Okay.
So you can try this. Catch. So array index out of bound, I'm just copying it just so that I will not need to write it. I'm running it once again. So look at this. Even if there is something wrong, it is ignoring that line. Now there is no exception. Now there is no exception. So this is how you handle your exceptions. Okay?
Yeah.
So you can also, if there are multiple exceptions, you can also, you know, try to catch all of them. So you can just, if let's say that there is one more error, like if I say I am dividing it by 10, I am dividing it by 0. This is again some exception, right? See, arithmetic exception is also there. So we can try to catch, so there can be one try block and there can be multiple catch blocks. Okay. So you can also try to catch it. Okay. So let's say catch. Let me just copy it. Okay, look at this. So 8, 9, 9 is giving you nothing. Dividing 9 by 0, it's not giving me anything. Right? It's ignoring. So although we have exceptions, still it's running. So you can use one try block, multiple catch. Any questions on this? On exception handling?
No.
Okay. Now we will talk about the finally block. We just talked about try and catch block. We are going to talk about the finally block. Okay. So finally block is used to execute the important code. If there is something important, okay, such as when you are running some database operation, at the end of the program, you want to close all your databases due to security concerns. Okay, at the end of the program, you want, before leaving the program, all the databases should be closed. Okay, so it will help you to do that, the finally log. Okay, like after using your cache, you can also add your finally block, which will be, no matter what, it will always be executed. Finally block will always be executed. Okay, just to help you with the you know, if there is some error or anything. Let's say we have some message here. We have successfully managed the exceptions. So we have successfully managed the exception. But if a question is raised that what is that the finally block can do? Okay. So you can say the finally block is always executed whether the exception is handled or not handled. Even if the exception is not handled, the finally block will always be executed. Okay. And it is used to execute if there is something important. You can keep your important piece of code in the finally block so that will be always executed, even if there is some exception. So we are done with the try catch and finally blocks. Okay, we can also use the throw keyword. Okay, what is the throw keyword? We will see just a little of it. I don't know how much you need to cover in the Java programming, because you are in standard 11, I guess, right?
Yeah.
11, okay. So the exception handling must be in your syllabus, right? Is it?
Yeah.
Okay, and are they talking about the throwable exceptions like throw keyword and all? Have you ever checked?
No.
Okay, no matter. So you can check it anytime, but let me just explain it to you. What is the throw keyword? What is the work of it? So throw keyword we use to throw an exception. Okay. You can throw any checked or unchecked exception in Java, and it is mainly used to throw the custom exceptions. Okay, so these are the defined exceptions. These are the system defined exceptions that we talked about. For an example, if there is some other exception, okay, you can use the throw keyword so that it will throw the exception. If there is something wrong out of these, if there is some custom exception, it will help you do that. It will help you throw that particular exception. Okay. Let me give you an example how it's going to work. So I say here, Let me give you some other example. So I'm removing all of these. Okay. Let's say we have a method here, void validate. And then we have
are you typing?
I'm sorry?
Are you typing?
Am I? What?
Your screen is frozen.
Okay, my screen is frozen. You don't yeah. see it move?
No.
Okay. Can you see it now?
No. I can see. Yeah, it changed. Yeah, I can see it now.
Okay, good. Is less than 18. Let's say so may exception. Not valid is by else so we are going to discuss about the I'm trying to show you some example for the keyword throw. So whenever you will use the throw keyword, it will be help it throw keyword will help you to show the custom messages, custom exception messages. Like I am showing here custom message, not valid is to drive. Can you see my screen? Satwik, can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay. So it was validate. So I will say validate. And then I will error and then whatever I have. Okay, so if I run this program, if I run this program, let me enter here another message. you can see when you are passing 13, the error is less than, the age is less than 18, so it's giving you the exception and this message. Okay, if you are you have 18 here, it will give you valid age and this looks fine now. Okay, so you have the custom exception messages by using the throw keyword. Okay, so this is all about the exceptions. Any question for today?
No.
How about your program? The program you worked on yesterday.
You want me to show it to you?
I mean, did it work or not?
Yeah, it worked.
It worked? Okay, great. So did you, I think today we had to print some tricks or something like that. Did it work?
Yeah, I fixed it. I troubleshooted it.
Oh, okay, cool. Okay, so this is all for today. See you on Monday. And you will have two more classes, two more sessions, Monday and Tuesday. Okay, Satvik?
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, happy weekend. Welcome. Bye.